one man. My father said, that house right there? She said, yeah. See, that's Dr. Sweet's house. See, that's the house that I had in my dream. That's the house I dreamed about. And my father bought it for her. At that time, in 58, when they moved in, prior to that, there were a lot of squatters who lived in the home. They had fireplaces in the basement to keep the house warm. Every room, with the exception of the kitchen was used as a bedroom. So. They were able to come in here, move into the house in 58, and raise a family. I was born in 65. My sister, she was born in 54. This is my sister Monica. She was born in 1954. And then my brother William, he was born in 64. So I'm the youngest of all of the kids that were born in this house. So even though Dr. Sweet didn't realize the dream that he wanted to see for his family, because of what he did, my family had that opportunity.
I read about Dr. Sweet was what he said when Clarence Darrow put him on the witness stand. Clarence Darrow asked him the question. He said, Dr. Sweet, what were you thinking when you saw all the people in front of your house? And Dr. Sweet said this. He said, when I opened the door and I saw the mob, I realized that I was facing the same mob that had hounded my people throughout his entire history. In my mind, I was pretty confident of what I was up against. I had my back against the wall, and I was filled with a peculiar fear, the fear of one who knows the history of my race. I know what mobs have done to my people before. And then he began to give a dissertation of mob violence and lynchings that had occurred in the South. That statement resonated with me as a child. And very often, if you look right there in that top floor in that center window, that's my mom and dad's room, and that was Dr. Sweet's bedroom. The story says that when he saw the mob, he went upstairs and he laid in that bed because he didn't know what to do. He was filled with that fear. And the only thing that kind of put him back into the moment was the fact that a rock came through the window. As a child, I tried vigorously to look through that window, stand at the front door, and stand in the middle of this intersection and try to imagine what that peculiar fear felt like. Try as I may, there was no way that I would have an opportunity to experience that feeling, simply because Dr. Sweet did what he did in 1925. He was a trailblazer. We stand on his shoulders. W.E.B. Du Bois came up with this notion of the talented 10th, meaning that 10% of all the black men in the world would lift their people up by going back to school to perpetuate their education, to write books, and be on the front line of social change. Well, Dr. Sweet was that man who stood on the front line. And as a consequence, I had an opportunity to live at that house on 2905 Garland. And I enjoyed a magnificent childhood. If you ever saw the movie, The Wizard of Oz, Emerald City and the color, the technicolor, that's how my childhood was. Because I had many of the things that Dr. Sweet wanted for his daughter, Iva. As you know, Iva died of tuberculosis. His wife, Gladys, died of tuberculosis. And his brother, Henry, died of tuberculosis as a result of being confined in that prison. But while they didn't have an opportunity to enjoy that and reap that benefit, the promise of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence to enjoy life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, I had the opportunity. My sister Monica had that opportunity. My brother William had that opportunity. So the mobs of 1925 were never relevant to us. But as a young man, I always knew how important that was. And that's why I went back to school to understand the history of our people, African Americans, and what occurred when we came here from Africa to the United States. So Not to be too long, I want to cut this off. I just want to say thank you, and I appreciate this opportunity, and I recognize that when history is your landlord, you have a greater responsibility to America and the world. Thank you.